bring in our first speaker today, Kellie Armstrong, who will bring, I think, a unique insight to this. Kellie is an Alliance MLA representing Strangford. Kellie sponsored the successful Integrated Education Bill in the last session, introducing a new duty on the executive to support integrated schools. I will turn my video off now and pass you over to your first speaker.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for having me along to your conference today. I'm delighted to be speaking to people about the Integrated Education Act as it now is, because in the run-up to it, not many people wanted to speak to me about the Act. In fact, they just wanted to criticise. I will share my screen in a moment, but it was just to start off with a background why I felt that the Integrated Education Bill as it was and Act as it now is was very important. As you have heard, integrated education is a small part of the education system in Northern Ireland. There are four sectors in Northern Ireland. So there's integrated education, there's Irish medium, there's the controlled maintained sector and the controlled sector. The maintained sector would be with the Catholic Church, and the maintained sector is the state school system, which is largely perceived in Northern Ireland to be Protestant faith-based. Integrated education is one of the smallest, not the smallest, and Irish medium is by far the smallest of all of the sectors, but our integrated education comes very closely behind. The number of children attending integrated schools in Northern Ireland makes up about 7% of the total school population, so it is still quite small 40 years after its inception. What we have found looking at the good relations report that are published by the Executive Office, that's First Minister and Deputy First Minister's Office in Northern Ireland, is that a growing number of children who apply to go to an integrated school are not given that opportunity. One in five children are turned away from their first preference of post-primary school choice. That means that families who would prefer to have their child at an integrated school often don't have the opportunity of going to an integrated school because the school in their area is heavily oversubscribed, or there isn't an integrated option in their area. Today in Northern Ireland, it's post-primary transfer day, and I know already that in the local post-primary school in my area, a full year group worth of children will not be able to access their local integrated school, that's Strangford Integrated College, because the school is so heavily oversubscribed. They have been awarded temporary variations. They're looking for a development proposal to increase the numbers in the school. However, we have found that the Department for Education in Northern Ireland has already turned them down for a development proposal because of the thought that they would take pupils away from other schools, not other integrated schools, just other schools, which is very disappointing. So when I became an MLA in 2016, when I was elected the first time to the Northern Ireland Assembly, I decided that I thought it was very unfair the how that integrated education was treated, that it was separated and kept separated from the rest of education with the dominance of the controlled and the maintained sectors. So I decided, I don't know whether I was mad to do so or not, but I decided to take forward the Integrated Education Bill. I got permission from the Speaker to say that it was legally competent for me to do that. I wrote to the Minister, who confirmed that at that stage he had no intentions of bringing forward any legislation for integrated education. And so my journey for the Integrated Education Bill continued. Throughout the process, the bill was hammered left, right and centre by anyone who could oppose it, did oppose it. It was claimed that I didn't communicate or correspond or consult with people, but believe me, that definitely happened. So I went out to consultation. I did two types of consultation. One was for adults, one was for children, and not just everybody who was fans of integrated education. It was a public consultation. And on the basis of that public consultation, I came up with a number of policy objectives they wanted to achieve within the bill. And I'm delighted to say that with a lot of argument and a lot of negotiation and a lot of persistence, I actually did manage to get most of those objectives. And I just want to share my screen with you so that you can see the type of policy objectives that I had in place. Sorry, bear with me. So you'll see there, the Integrated Education Act, I'll stop calling it a bill because it is, has got royal assent. It had 9 policy objectives. The most important of those was it placed a duty on the Department of Education and other education bodies to support, not merely encourage and facilitate the development of integrated education. The words encourage and facilitate had been built into legislation in the past, but they were lip service. There wasn't an awful lot happening with integrated education. So I deliberately put in the term support, and I'll explain that in a moment. This would require the department to ensure that resources were dedicated for the sector, for the integrated education sector. It would require the department to ensure proper auditing of demand. That's how many parents and families wanted their children to go to an integrated school, and to put in place options to make sure that demand could be met. Because as I said before, the good relations indicator had been telling the department for years that, you know, there were a number of children being turned away, 1 in 5 being turned away from integrated schools because there wasn't any places for them, and the department was doing really nothing about that. It was up to the schools themselves and their parents to push forward for development proposals, or in places you could have a controlled school or a maintained school that wanted to transform to become integrated, but it was parent-led as opposed to departmental-led. I also wanted to require the education authority. So Northern Ireland's education system is a hierarchy of organisations. So the Department of Education is at the top. Beneath that, you'll have the education authority and there are other sectoral bodies. And we'll go into those later. But I wanted the education authority to report and publish on the auditing of demand to the department of the parental choice for integrated education, and to take account of that in budget and budgeting and planning decisions. I also required the education bodies to consider integrated education when planning for a new school. Up until now, the education authority, Department of Education, didn't have to think about a new school if one was being developed. That was up to parents who in the past have remortgaged houses, have set up as Lagan College, the oldest integrated school, had to do in a I think it was a scout hut way back in the early 1980s, and to ask them to actually consult and publish a report on their consultations when they were considering integrated education for a new school. I also wanted an integrated education strategy that would be led by the department, not by parents, not by the Northern Ireland Council for Integrated Education, but by the department and the education authority. And that's to be published 6 months after the commencement of the Act. The Act commenced at the end of March. So in 6 months' time, if we have a Northern Ireland Assembly, there should be a report indicating what that strategy will start to look like. And I also wanted a report on the implementation of the Act, and for that not to just be produced and sat on the shelf, that has to be produced and brought forward to the Northern Ireland Assembly for scrutiny. That was an important part of the Act, and it was one that I tried to hold on to as long as possible throughout my negotiations with the other parties. I also asked the Department of Education to dedicate funding to the remit of the strategy to ensure that the strategy wasn't just a poor report that's written with no substance to it, that they actually had to invest in this strategy and to increase their team to ensure that the strategy had actually personnel that would work on that. I also required the department to ensure that there's a dedicated departmental resource to help schools strengthen their ethos. Because integrated education is all about ethos. It's all about making sure that children are respected and respect each other. And I'll talk a little bit more about the importance of the ethos after this and why there were such objections to this Act. But in putting forward this dedicated departmental response, it meant then that the ethos of integrated education would be upheld and be respected and be demanded to be actually held to a level of compliance that meant then that integrated education would stay separate to the other sectors. I also required then that those integrated schools would be inspected by the Education and Training Inspectorate Team, ETI, as part of their usual programme of inspections, and that would ensure that the ethos could be tested and held up. And when I spoke to many of the schools, they said, yep, we have no problem being tested about our ethos because we live that on a daily basis. Just, I'll stop sharing just for a second, just to come back to you to explain. So what I did with the bill to ensure that people could understand, because there's a lot of complaints about the bill, because how dare I say that integrated schools were separate from other schools, because controlled and maintained schools were all saying, but we have a mixture of children within our classes. Integrated schools are nothing special. They just happen to have a label on them. So what I did was I defined the meaning of integrated education in the new Act. So it means integrated education. In the past, just to be clear, integrated education was always about the mixing of Protestant and Catholic children, and those of others' faiths or no faith were treated separately. It was all about Catholics and Protestants. Didn't like that, so I changed it and I said integrated education means the education together in an integrated school of those of different cultures and religious beliefs and of none, including reasonable numbers of both Protestant and Roman Catholic children or young persons, and of those who are experiencing socioeconomic deprivation, and those who are not, and those of different abilities. So what that meant is that integrated schools, for instance, there's a wonderful integrated school, Malone College, who has a wealth, an enormous part of their school body, are newcomer children to Northern Ireland. There's a number of languages spoken within that school. However, all records up to the point of this Act, have only ever considered how many of them are Protestant and how many of them are Catholic. There was always this push for 40-40-20, 40% Protestant, 40% Catholic, and 20 can be whoever else happens to be there. So I have changed that meaning of integrated education, and it also allows schools now to reflect really on who the school body is and who their teachers are, because integrated education is not just about the diversity of children that are taught in the school, it's also about the diversity of their teaching and non-teaching staff and their board of governors, to ensure that the whole school is respectful of everyone's diversity and welcoming of it. I also redefined what an integrated school was and put that definition in to say that it intentionally supports, protects and advances an ethos of diversity, respect and understanding between those of different cultures and religious beliefs and of none, between those of different socioeconomic backgrounds and between those of different abilities. I clearly set out that you can only use the term integrated education or integrated school if the school has acquired grant maintained integrated status or controlled integrated status through the existing piece of legislation in Northern Ireland, which is the Education Reform Northern Ireland Order 1989. I also accepted a number of amendments from other parties with regards to the purpose of integrated education, and I hope when I read this you'll understand why I brought this in. So the purpose of integrated education is to deliver, of course, educational benefits to children and young persons, to promote awareness and appreciation of human rights, to promote equality of opportunity, to promote good relations, and to promote respect for identity, diversity and community cohesion. So that basically set out now in law what integrated education is, and the policy objectives that I was looking to achieve, thankfully, have made it through from the very early drafts right through. I did throw a few clangers, I have to say, into the original drafting of the bill, because I put in things like every new school has to be an integrated school, knowing that people would concentrate on that and maybe let other things go through. Like, for instance, the word support. Now, the word support, I said earlier that when this was going through, I wanted to force the Department for Education to support integrated education, because up until that point, they had been paying lip service to the type of help that they should have been providing. So just to confirm for you, the clever part of this Act is meaning of support, a reference in any provision of Northern Ireland legislation to support for integrated education, including support for the development of integrated education, is a reference to identifying, assessing, monitoring and aiming to meet demand for the provision of integrated education within the context of area planning and the overall sustainability of the school estate, including in particular monitoring the number and success of applications for integrated education, and providing sufficient places in integrated schools to aim to meet the demand for integrated education, again, within the context of area planning and overall sustainability of the school estate. That is a game changer for integrated education in Northern Ireland, because up until this point, a parent could put down that they wanted their children to go to an integrated school, and if they didn't get in, so what? Now, just the same as controlled and maintained schools, if a parent or a child is denied access to an integrated school, now the Department of Education will have to consider it, right, okay, a child who, or a parent, family who wants to send their child to a controlled or maintained school may not get their first preference, but they will always get a place in one of those schools. Integrated education, as soon as this strategy and the reporting starts to come forward, will be the same. So we should see an increase in the number of pupils being able to attend integrated schools. As a result of that, I'm hoping that the number of different types of teachers that teach in integrated schools will increase, because up till now it's been quite limited. There had been a preference for those in the maintained sector, that's Catholic sector, not to teach in integrated schools, and were encouraged to do so by one of the teacher training colleges, who I have to say threw me out whenever I went to meet them about my act, but I've been thrown out of worse places. So I tried my best with that, and I'm just going to share my screen again just to move on to my next slide for you. Sorry, bear with me. So let me see if this will move forward for you. Yeah. So who were the objectors to the bill? And you can see there's a copy of the Integrated Education Act, which I wept buckets after I found out Her Majesty had signed it. The objectors are politicians. The DUP, absolutely opposed. If you're looking to be depressed, all you have to do is read some of the comments made by the Minister for Education, who's a member of the DUP, and some of her colleagues, how critical they were, okay, of me, I can take that any day, but of integrated education. We also, at the very start of the negotiations for this bill, had Sinn Féin coming in and being very critical, saying it was a British format and people who had an Irish background weren't included in those schools. Thankfully, as we moved through the bill process, they apologised for that and actually came very strongly on board. The Ulster Unionists took a view that integrated education erodes Christianity and it erodes Christian teaching within schools, so they went against it. Sadly, one of the independents, Claire Sugden, who had been quite supportive, was nobbled near the end of the bill's process and voted against the bill because she was very unhappy that controlled schools, that state schools, that felt that they should have been put into this bill and called integrated schools without having to comply with ethos. The SDLP, Social Democratic Labour Party, they voted for the bill, but if you read the speeches that were made by their two representatives through the bill process, you would think that they were totally against it. All of the churches were opposed to it. Of course, the employing bodies, that's the CCMS, the Catholic Council for Maintained Schools, sorry, and all of their schools, and the CSSC, which is a representative body on behalf of controlled schools, it's the Controlled Sector Schools Council, were opposed to it, and the Department of Education. And just to give you a flavour of the type of things that came forward, on the left-hand side, Glastry College, it's a letter from a college that's local within my school. This is a letter that was provided to the college by CSSC, where they basically tore the bill apart. The open letter in the centre and the signatures to the right-hand side came from the Council for Catholic Maintained Schools, the Controlled Schools Support Council, the Governing Bodies Association, the Chief Executive of the Catholic Schools Trustees. There's that many groups in Northern Ireland that have a say over schools, it's unbelievable. And then the Transferers Representatives Council all put this open letter out just before the final vote on the bill to try to nobble the bill. What they were basically saying is that, you know, with less than 10% of the school population, why should integrated education have any support, which was very unhelpful. I have to say that, as Stephen mentioned at the start, I don't know what happened, but there seemed to be a complete change within the system in Northern Ireland, and we actually got support, even though all of the unionist parties voted against the bill. Because SDLP were whipped to vote for it, Sinn Féin came in behind me. The Green Party, Claire Bailey, the leader of the Green Party, actually attended Lagan College in its very early days. So they weighed in. People Before Profit, Socialist Party came in and supported it. And of course, my own party, the Alliance Party. And on that basis, then we had a majority and we actually got this act passed. This is something that doesn't happen very often. Such a complicated private members bill doesn't normally make it this far. And it did go through. It is an act. And I know already that the Department for Education are starting to cause problems for integrated schools by asking them, you know, that they need to provide an extraordinary amount of information to comply with their integrated ethos. But the schools are working with me on that. One other thing, just to give you a bit of heart about, is I was part of the negotiations on New Decade, New Approach. That was the agreement that got the Northern Ireland Assembly back and working again after 3 years of collapse. And on page 43 of New Decade, New Approach, you can look up, we had put into a piece on education, and it says, the education system has a diversity of school types, each with its own distinctive ethos and values. However, it is not sustainable. The parties acknowledge the progress made in developing new models of sharing, cooperation and integration. There is a desire to build on this as a basis for delivering long-term improvements in the quality, equity and sustainability of the system. The parties agree that the executive will commission and oversee an independent fundamental review with a focus on quality and sustainability. The education experience and outcomes for children and young people are the most important factors. And the footnote on page 43, I'm delighted to say that myself and my policy officer, Fiona McAteer, who was amazing throughout the whole act, was written by us, and we actually managed to keep it in. And there's a civil servant owes me. He said he would eat his hat if that stayed in, and it did. So he still owes me a hat eating. In this document, education means education for children and young people in early years, primary, post-primary or further education settings. Education includes all aspects of education, including sectoral bodies, the ETI, that's the inspectorate, curriculum, area planning, 14 to 19 strategy, entitlement framework, teacher training and the interface between higher education and further education. So this independent review that's looking at a single education system is happening at the moment. I have to say, I'm not convinced that it will actually come out with the innovative way that a lot of the parties had wanted to happen in New Decade, New Approach. But goodness knows who the next education minister will be. If it's not me, I hope to be on the education committee for a change. The other thing just to say to you, just in winding, is I'm delighted that my colleague Chris Little, in the dying days of the last assembly mandate, managed to get changes to the Fair Employment Treatment Order to remove the exemption from teachers to be excluded from fair employment. It now means that all schools have to employ teachers based on their skills and cannot use their religion in order to recruit them for their schools. Amazing change. That's me for now. It was a heck of a ride doing the Integrated Education Act, and I'm hoping that in the next mandate we can further on more progress to a single education system in Northern Ireland.